G'day. This is going to be my my first attempt at live streaming on Twitch, and let's see how it goes. Let's see if we get anyone watching. So what I'm going to be doing is showing you how to actually conduct a meta-analysis using R, and this is going to be modeled off of my paper, which was called From Pre-Registration to Publication, and it basically walks you through how to perform a meta-analysis from scratch. Now, there are a lot of issues within meta-analysis, particularly when it comes to pre-registration and actually choosing a relevant research question, but for this particular live stream, I'm just going to be going through the coding on how to actually do it. Okay, so the first thing you want to do is to obviously install your packages in R. So let's run that. Okay, all the packages are getting installed, and all this script is online as part of my paper. So if you want to follow along and do it yourself, then you can do that. Okay, so now all our packages are getting loaded, so we are all there and we are ready to go. Now, for this particular example, all the data is already included within the metaphor package. So let's actually get the data with this command here, and we can have a look at the data and see what it looks like. So for this particular data set, this is looking at the relationship between a personality measures, and so we have a number of studies here, and we have the year, we have the number in this particular study, keeping in mind this is a correlational meta-analysis, and we have Pearson's R value all down here, and there's also a few moderator analyses or a few other particular variables that we can actually put into the analysis, for instance whether there was controls, the particular study design, and the type of measure that was used as well. And there's also a measure of study quality here too. So there's those actually move from 1 to 2. Okay, now let's go back, and what we want to do is we want to add a study ID column. That's going to help us later on in our analysis. So we'll have a look, and that's updated, and we can see that didn't do anything. Let's try again. Okay, there we go. Study ID, it's right at the end. So it's there, but we want to actually bring this to the front. Let's have a look, bring it to the front here. Okay, so before it was at the back, and now it's at the front. Study ID, from 1 to 16. Okay. So the next thing we want to do, we can actually put a command in here, and we can look at the data by running this command, but that's exactly the same as actually pressing on the button here. Okay, let's go back, and what we can do is this is what you would do if you were actually working with your own data set. You would put the name of your CSV file here and you would read it in. But for this particular analysis, what we are doing is we're using the data that's using the example here. Okay, so the first thing we want to do is to transform the, as we can see here, these are Pearson's R statistics. But Pearson's R statistics don't work very well in meta-analysis. So what you really want to do is convert them to Fisher Z, and then from there, once you convert it to Fisher Z, you can calculate the corresponding sample variances. Because when you're actually doing a meta-analysis, the two things that you need to include is a measure of effect size and a measure of variance. Now, one of the cool functions within metaphor is you can actually calculate the effect size. You can calculate the effect, and you can calculate the variance. And that's one of the functions that's included within metaphor. So what we're doing here, and that's called the ESCalc function, is we'll add that and we'll run this, and this is going to calculate. And here we actually specify RI, which is the effect, and NI, which is the number. And those variables are actually given those same names within there. So we run that. Oh, that's a mistake. Okay, there we go. So we are running that, and now we can see at the end we have these new measures. We have a measure of effect here, YI, and a measure of variance. Now that we have those two measures, now we can perform our meta-analysis. And those two measures, we got those two measures from the participant, from the numbers in those in the meta-analysis, and the effects the effect size, which is Pearson's R. Okay, so we have those two things here. And now we are ready to perform the meta-analysis. So we run this command here. Okay, down here we can actually see the effect of the meta-analysis. So what we have is it's calculated an overall estimate. So the Fisher's Z statistic is 0.1499, and the p-value is less than 0.001. So it's quite a small p-value there. But the thing is, quite often when we're actually reporting our statistics, we don't usually use Fisher's Z as a measure when we're reporting our statistics. So we want to actually convert that back to Pearson's R. So with this command here, we can do that. Bring this back to, so it's transforming back from F. Okay, so basically what we're doing here is we've actually got a prediction, and then we've got Pearson's R, which has been back transformed, and we also have the confidence intervals. Now, when you're actually dealing with very small values of Pearson's R up until around 0.23 is actually very similar to Fisher's Z. Only when you actually get beyond 0.23 do you actually start to see a divergence between these two figures. Okay. So here we have the results of the meta-analysis. We also have a test for heterogeneity. The p-value, what we have here with the p-value is it's 0.009. So here there is evidence, or at least the test for heterogeneity was statistically significant. So there's something about these studies which are very heterogeneous. Okay, so let's move on down. And see what we have here. Now, one cool feature of the metaphor is we can actually run a set of diagnostics using the influence function. So let's do that. Let's have a look what the output is. Okay, so a lot of numbers here, but we can actually plot them as well using this plot function. And let's zoom in and have a look. Now, if any of these studies, any of these 1 to 16 studies actually had any evidence of or were causing any large evidence of influence on the overall meta-analysis, this would come up as red. Now, none of these studies were. So the thing with meta-analysis, or the thing with these influence diagnostics, is that there's actually no hard and fast rules when it comes to what is considered an influential study. There's a few rules of thumb, but it's worth actually looking at all these particular measures. There are 8 here. But it's worth looking at these measures to actually see which one of them are actually causing or have evidence for causing a bit of influence. And if you actually look at the output down here, any studies which were masked, there's an inf or influence column at the end, and any studies which have any evidence of having undue influence on the overall meta-analysis, there'd be an asterisk there, but in this case there wasn't. But it is a nice little diagnostic to run. So we do have some cool numbers, but what you're usually used to seeing for meta-analysis is looking at a forest plot. So let's run the forest plot here. Here we go. Okay, so of course, this actually mirrors what we found originally. We have the overall effect size of 0.15 with the confidence intervals, and we can actually see the effect sizes and the confidence intervals for each particular study with the authors, with the year, and we have the correlations reported here. So we can see there was a bit of a range. A lot of these studies were statistically significant. Quite a few weren't, because they crossed the zero here. But you can actually see there's a pretty clear pattern there, and we do have overall significance there with the diamond. Okay, now one common thing which is also done is looking at a funnel plot. So let's have a look at the funnel plot here. Now, funnel plots are quite often used as a measure of a publication bias. And this is bad in two ways. Firstly, these funnel plots are more likely, or they're more appropriately a measure of small study bias, which can happen to include publication bias. Now, that's a different issue. But quite often, people actually look at these funnel plots, and what they say is, well, they use the naked eye to see, is there any evidence here of asymmetry And people will eyeball it going, well, there's no asymmetry. But this is incredibly, incredibly subjective. So that's a huge problem. But anyway, it's a very simple command to actually run the funnel plot just using here. Now there are more, that's actually looking at this funnel plot is very subjective, but there are actually more objective tests of asymmetry. So we can run Egger's regression test here, and we can actually see, according to Egger's regression test, that there was no significant evidence of funnel plot asymmetry. Now, like I said before, this doesn't mean that there's no publication bias. It just means there's not necessarily much evidence for small study bias. There are ways that you can specifically address publication bias. One of these methods is called p-uniform. You should check that one out if you want to specifically target publication bias. But anyway, it still is good to be looking at small study bias, and funnel plots are a great way of visualizing this, and Egger's regression test is a more objective way of looking at this. Now, one method which I don't really recommend to use that much, but I've included it anyway, is the trim and fill procedure, and that is something you can do to actually impute the so-called missing studies in a meta-analysis. But that's it's fairly straightforward to do with a metaphor, but I wouldn't really recommend it. I think it's important. When I originally wrote this paper a few years ago, I thought, well, we should include this because it's important to know. But of course, I think within academia, it's important to change your mind sometimes. And in retrospect, if I was to write the paper again, I actually wouldn't have included trim and fill, because it's more a measure of sensitivity. And I just see a lot of people misusing it and using it as a way to actually make statistical inferences. But the data isn't really there, so I don't think it's a fair way of doing it. Okay, so one thing which is commonly used within meta-analysis is looking at moderators, the effect of moderators. So one thing that we have, if we look at our data set, is we have a measure of mean age. So within each study, a measure of mean age was collected, which ranges from 22 up until 77. So there's quite a range there. So what we can do is we can actually see, is the overall effect size that we see actually moderated by age? Is there a difference between studies which actually report a higher or a lower mean age? And we can look at this within metaphor. So as before, we put in our commands of effect and variance, and we also include a command for a moderator. And in this, we're looking at the moderator of mean age, which is this column here. Okay, so we're looking at that. Let's run it. Okay, so here, looking at this test of moderator, because the p-value is greater than 0.05, it looks like age doesn't actually have a significant impact on the overall outcome here. The other thing we can do is we can look at the, we had a measure here of quality, of study quality from 1 to 3. So some studies are 1, some are 2, and 1 are 3. So we can actually see, is the overall effect size actually influenced by quality. So we can run the analysis there. Okay, so there's no evidence there as well. So it looks like there's no moderating effect of quality. Okay, now let's look at a more categorical variable. So we're looking at whether there was any effect of whether there was any the variables were controlled for. So we have none, multiple, none or multiple. So there's basically two different categories there. So we can run that. Okay, so we can actually see the test of moderators was statistically significant. So it seems like there was actually a difference between these two categories here. Okay, so I think I'll wrap that up. That's my first attempt at doing a Twitch coding live stream looking at meta-analysis. So if you're interested more in performing it yourself, check out the paper, which is right here, and this is the title. And hopefully I'll be back with more live coding. So bye for now.